I'm a fire chief and I'm not a scientist. But when I look back over my career, I cannot deny that fire season is now longer. I cannot deny that fires are harder to extinguish. I'm not going to argue what's causing the climate to change. I'm here to tell you that I have a front row seat to the results of this changing climate.
To understand the changes we're seeing today, we need to understand the past. In the early 1900s, a new organization called the Forest Service was formed, and its mandate was to put out all fires as quickly as possible. The early 1900s were hot and dry, and that didn't just cause the Dust Bowl. There was also a lot of fire. In fact, many researchers believe that there was more fire then than there is now. By the 1940s, firefighting had become professional and efficient, but wildfire was still a huge problem in the West. Then ocean currents shifted, bringing cooler, wetter conditions to much of the Western US. It also made fires far easier to fight.
We had these incremental wet periods during the summer. Incremental rains every week or two, just enough to tamp down fire behavior and support the fire managers to get out there and suppress those fires.
And under these conditions, firefighting worked. Acres burned per year plummeted.
That's where we started in the Western United States, really interacting with the landscape and developing our expectations on what the landscape could provide for us. And that's the period of that great expansion. We see communities expanding. We see the land utilization expanding. We've expanded our recreation resources. We've expanded our water infrastructure. We've expanded our power infrastructure. And we've expanded our timber bases under the expectation that that's sustainable into the future.
And most importantly, we expanded where we lived. But then things changed again. By the 1980s, the Western US had left that cool, wet period. The number of acres burned per year began to rise. But now, there are whole towns, cities, farms, and infrastructure filling in our fire-prone areas. And now, we layer on top of that expansion the warmest year in human history. On our current trajectory, the warming we've seen could double by the end of the century. And this really matters when it comes to fire because as temperatures increase, the ability for the atmosphere to hold water vapor also increases, and it's exponential. You can basically think of the atmosphere as a giant sponge that can absorb and then release water. The warmer the atmosphere, the bigger the sponge. And this has two effects. First, when that moisture is released, it leads to more extreme precipitation. But when conditions are dry, a thirstier atmosphere does the opposite. It pulls moisture from the land, sucking water from plants and soil, creating the perfect conditions for fire to spread faster and burn hotter. This dramatic shift between extremes is what some scientists call weather whiplash. And that whiplash had a big role in the LA firestorm. All right, so we've been hearing a lot about climate change and how it may have influenced these fires, so we're actually gonna meet up with someone who can explain it to us. So let's go. Oh, wow, I'm back in school. How you doing? I'm Maya.
Hey Maya, I'm Park.
Nice to meet you.
You can think of wildfire as being a light that is either on or off, but with fire, you can only turn on the light if you have four switches on at the same time.
These switches include fuels, aridity, fire weather, like strong dry winds, and ignition.
2023 and 2024 was extraordinarily wet. Lots of new plants grew. This is just a record of the greenness in coastal Southern California for the last 40 years. And this past spring was near record high, meaning that probably we haven't seen fuel loads like this more than once or twice in the last four decades.
Wow. And that was due to all of those atmospheric rivers that we saw rolling through California.
That's right.
And that leads us to the next ingredient, which is aridity.
This year has been an extraordinarily unlucky year so far. Usually we get our first rain by sometime in October or November, and here we are in mid to late January. We still haven't had our first rain. The vegetation and structures are probably drier than we've seen any time in the last 150 years at least. Another contributor to that is temperature. Heat works to dry out fuels because heat causes the atmosphere to be thirstier.
Another factor is wind, right?
That's right. Now, this, though, is the middle of Santa Ana wind season. Santa Anas are strongest and most common in December and January. Usually, they can't dry fire because usually everything's all wet by then. What made this year extraordinary was the huge amount of fuel, the very, very dry conditions because of lack of precipitation, high temperatures, and then to cap it off, a really strong Santa Ana wind event.
And there is one more factor, which is ignition.
Yeah, that's right. So in coastal Southern California, when we have these fires going in Santa Ana wind events, essentially all of the fires were caused by people. Lightning does not occur during these events. Unfortunately, when conditions are this extreme and perfect for fire, it's almost inevitable that there is going to be an accidental spark somewhere, and those accidental sparks have a really easy time lighting very destructive fires under these crazy weather conditions.
It just seems like a perfect storm.
It has been a perfect storm, but this type of event is the type of event we expect to see more of in the future.
At this point, Park's research shows that only one of these factors has definitively changed due to global warming: temperature. Record-breaking heat removes moisture faster, priming vegetation, fences, hedges, and homes. And that explains why fires are moving so much faster.
You can watch Weathered Inside the LA Firestorm for free on the PBS app and pbs.org right now. Head to the link in the description for more info.